community meeting for the Japantown Corp Yard project. For those of you that have been with us from the beginning, this is our third community meeting related to this project. As you know, the zoning for the project was approved back in November 2015. We met a few weeks ago to discuss the protected intersection, and today we're going to need to talk about the PD permit and the parks, the really fun stuff, because today we're going to delve into some design, we're going to look at the park, we're going to hear your ideas. And so I'm not going to take a long time because we've got a lot of material to cover, but today we're going to have Matt Brown, Williams, and Dane speak to you. We're going to have Dave Peter with Ankrom Moisan. The second part of the meeting will be with parks, and we'll have Kathy Levesque and KenKay, who is our urban designer for the park. So I'm going to turn it over to Dave. Matt first.
Okay, thank you. I think I've met a lot of you in the past. My name's Matt Brown with Williams and Dane Development. I also want to point out Susan Smart with Related, our partner, is here tonight as well. Let's go to the next slide if we could. I just want to provide a brief kind of overview of where we've been and what we've been doing for the last few months since you last saw us. First of all, a lot of our development program has been set, and this was actually part of what was approved by City Council for PD zoning back in December. So tonight, we're showing a plan that has about 520 residential units split between two buildings, about 789 total parking spaces, including parking for the CCA and also for retail. About 19,000 square feet of retail in the south building along Jackson Sts. Public parking plaza, which Ken will present a little bit later. And then also our partners at the Creative Center for the Arts, a permanent home for our arts organizations in San Jose, Tyco, on the site. Next. So what have we accomplished to date? The environmental impact report for the site has been certified. That allows up to 600 residential units, six-story height of buildings, and it also dealt with things like traffic impacts and other neighborhood impacts. We also executed a purchase and sale agreement with the city to purchase the property, a development agreement with the city to cover some of the other entitlements that go with the property. The PD zoning, so the zoning that entitled the property was approved in December. So things like the number of units, the building heights, the parking, all of those things have essentially all been approved already by City Council. And then we've also recently made some progress on some floodplain issues on the site. There's a very narrow sliver along Taylor and 7th that we have gotten approval from FEMA on. Next. It's gonna go, it will go. The next slide, I think, deals with then some of the development principles that we have shared with you in the past. And hopefully what you'll see tonight is how these development principles have carried through in the work that we've done. So tonight what we're doing is we're presenting to you kind of the next part of the design process, which is really getting at the look and feel of the buildings. And it's really been guided, you know, again, by these development principles, which we've been carrying forward for the last 10 years. So first and foremost is getting what we call being the first 30 feet right. Really focusing on the pedestrian environment around the base of the building, the public realm, the park, things like that. Making sure those are absolutely high quality dialed in. And really that's where the community is spending their time, right? It's not so much looking at the sixth floor of the building, but it's really down at the street level where the community happens. Pedestrian connections two and three the site are very important. That's one of the reasons that we have a site design like we do with a park in the middle and connections through it. So it's not this big, huge development block like you see in a lot of other parts of the city. Creating a sense of place, really honoring the culture, the diversity, and the history of this unique site. Our retail mix really wants to be diverse and complementary to what's already existing in Japantown. This is not a competitive retail, this is complementary to what a retail mix is today. Permanent home for San Jose Tyco, which has been a community priority for many, many years. And so we're really excited to see the CCA moving forward. And of course, high quality design throughout, which Dave and KenKay are going to share with you tonight. So I think with that, what I'd like to do is turn it over to Dave Peter, who's our architect with Ankrom Moisan, and he can walk you through some of our design.
Okay, thank you, Matt. So very pleased to be here tonight. This is a really great project for Ankrom Moisan. We have been working on this project off and on with Matt for almost a decade, and we are also very proud to be the designers of the community center in the park, although we're not going to be covering the architecture for that tonight. It's really just the park design. So what I want to present to you for the first time are some initial images and where we're going with the design for all of the apartments that are going to be happening on the site. Over the 10 years that we've been looking at this piece of property and this community, one of the things that really struck us, a couple of things, is the pattern of development. And we wanted to make sure that what we're proposing, especially the ground floor, the first 30 feet and all those uses and interaction between the residents that live here and all of you and anyone else coming to the neighborhood, that those development patterns are right. So Jackson Street, being a main commercial street and retail, we need to make sure that what we proposed there was going to support that. And then where we put units that come down to the ground level happen along to the north end of the site, where that pedestrian connection is different. Also, we've just been seeing how important public art was in the community. And art got us thinking a lot about some concepts, and we wanted to see how we could play those out in actually the design of the buildings. So next slide. One of the concepts about art that we just kept coming back to was this idea of origami, and there's three attributes to this particular art form that we're going to have. One is craft. The idea of craft, that origami as an art form, is something that it is what it is. It's very authentic. It's paper, and you see it, and you know it, and you touch it. The other is the idea of contrast. Origami is something that is very fragile, and yet it's also very strong in creating these folds. And so that, as a concept, was something that we're interested in pursuing in the architecture. And the final thing is pattern. That it's an art form that really relies on surfaces and faces and facets that create a play on light and texture. So these are all images that we started to pull together that remind us some imagery about that particular art form. And then we start talking about that concept, and then we start to move into how to apply that to real buildings and design. And you're going to see the result of that tonight. So just to orient you a little bit, this is the entire site. We're going to talk about the building on the north, which I'm going to call the Taylor Street building first. And we're going to walk around it. And then we'll move down 6th Street, and we'll talk about the Jackson Street building. These three diagrams on the top are important, showing you a progression of how this became two blocks. We wanted, it's such a large site, to make sure it was three distinct blocks, and it felt that way. And all these blocks were very porous. The park was very open, as Ken's going to show you. Wonderful public space. But also the blocks had a lot of porosity to them that were also appropriate to their ground floor uses. So that's that first diagram is showing. The second diagram is that all four faces of the building, when we create these blocks, need to respond to their own distinct sidewalk character and what was going on in a different way. So that's what that diagram is showing, that as each face and each building responds to the neighborhood, what was interesting to us was the seam between those parts. So it's almost like the joint that is created when the end of one block and the side of another block is coming together. Those were really interesting points, and you'll see we're using those points as ways to enter the buildings. It's part of that porosity, and they're also bringing light into the inside of the hallways for the residences. Also, when we started laying that pattern out, we noticed that it had a relationship to a traditional tatami mat and that pattern. And we thought that was a really nice tie-in with this particular community, how that's playing out and how those blocks are actually creating their own outdoor spaces, their own courtyards that are above the top of parking, structured parking. Those are related to the park. We've got the little red area, which we're calling a jewel box, which I'm going to talk about. So first thing to talk about is the Taylor Street block. here. This is on the north side. And we have lots of parking in these projects. Most of the parking is a whole level underground this. But there is some parking on this level. It's really important to have that parking, but also to screen that parking. So anyone walking around this project isn't aware of it, and it's all screened, and it's behind a layer of units. All of this pink that's shown here, those are individual residences, and those come down to the ground floor. Some are at ground floor, some are raised up just a little bit from the sidewalk height. And you can see we have quite a bit of a buffer zone wrapping those units, and we're going to show you what that looks like. The blue area is that jewel box, and that's meant to be an amenity space for the projects, for the residents, and it's going to interact with the park in a special way. So this first look will be along Taylor Street. Next. So that's what this is going to look like. When you bring units and residences down to the street level, the trick is that you want to make it very comfortable for the person living there. They want to get a lot of light into their unit. And so by creating these raised planters, those planters are actually covering up parking that's underneath them. So that's one thing that they're doing. But they also help to screen and give enough separation from someone living there so they feel comfortable having their windows open. It also creates some semi-public, semi-private space for an outdoor terrace. All of these residences will have a front door, and you can see a little canopy over those doors. And it's going to help provide a lot of the porosity on this Taylor Street building. As you walk around the corner, so this is on 6th, the scale changes a little bit. It's not quite as plain. There's a lot more ins and outs. And it's meant to look more like townhomes. So each unit is almost a separate bit of massing. So that's what you can see in these piers. We're still set back from the property line around about 7 feet. So you have a lot of area there for outdoor stoops and outdoor terraces, and a lot of area for planting and trees, again, over the parking. And we're trying to get that two-story rating, so again, it feels like townhouses, even though those are just single-floor residences. Behind that, high-quality materials on this building, so that we're using brick on these first two stories. That we wanted something that's very durable, that feels really good when you're walking by it, and it's just a high-quality, long-lasting material. So now we're stepping across 6th Street so you can get a feel for the end of the building along Taylor and most of the view along 6th. Most of the decks for this project are on 6th. That's going to be a quieter street. We're really trying to encourage a lot more pedestrian activity along 6th, even though we don't particularly have retail in this building, it's residences. We just really want to encourage people living there to come out onto their decks, and that encourages a sort of messy vitality on all of those decks, as you know when you look around at decks and terraces in the community around you. The jewel box is a particular special feature. Again, it's going to focus on a wellness portion of the community. They have a gym, and they have a spa, but really it's about health, and it has a connection to the park, so someone living here would be able to go there, and then they're immediately connected to the park and to the rest of the community. So I just wanted to share some of the slides materials. That is, the jewel box is covered with a screening element. It's almost like a veil. And when it's a building amenity, it's actually illuminated from within. Unlike units, a lot of time in residences, those lights come on and off as people are there. Whereas amenity space has more consistent lighting. So this is always going to be something that is glowing and has this veil that we're creating with a screen element. And that same screen element is going to show up on the decks. And that's where that idea of craft is really going to come in, and some of the details we're able to use with that material. Of course, the base of the building is all in an earthen kind of brick color. And then up above, we have a through color cementitious panel. And it's not a painted product. It's actually a natural cementitious product that has a lot of variation in color and tone. So that's going to give us a lot of texture for the whole top four levels of the building. Okay, so let's head to the south, to the Jackson Street building. These are the ground floor uses again, so it's very different. You don't see any of the pink. This is all blue. And so all of that is retail space. And we've got varying depths. We've got some areas that are a little bit deeper along 6th, and then not quite as deep along Jackson, and all of that is screening parking. The idea here is to provide lots of different places for retail that you can divide it into larger and smaller, and there's different different details along the sidewalk as well. It's important to note we've got a lot of area here between the retail and the property line. So that's all area that is part of the property, but the tenant or the retail owner, the shop owner can start to spill out into the sidewalk and they have additional room without starting to impinge on the public sidewalk area. So this is what that looks like. It was important for a small shop feel to happen along 6th between the park and Jackson Street. And so we're using a brick. This is a different brick. It's much darker in color, very earthy, very textural, and it has these pretty good piers, a lot of girth to them. And the idea is that we're able to get very individualistic feeling shop fronts. And of course, this is the deeper retail, so it's gonna, I think, attract smaller retail. It's gonna change over time. We're trying to bring warmth in to the underside of the canopy that you can see here. And this is right at the property line. So this is the one place where the project hits right on the property line. And we just want people to get up close and interact with that retail all along 6th Street. The residential units are set back over 10 feet on the top of the building. That's all a deck for the residences to use, and it's really encouraging people to live on top of those shops, which is something you really want to happen in a downtown portion of the community. And then the corner at 6th and Jackson is where we really want to amp up the transparency. So this is the place where you're going to see the most glazing at the ground floor. We want there to be canopies, so the area providing shade, and it's just where retail, even if it's a food and beverage, really has the most space to spill out onto to the sidewalk and become a real community amenity. And a lot of it is your first snapshot and gateway into the rest of the project. So now we're backing up, and now you can see how it all fits together. Portion of the building along 6th is meant to look almost like townhomes. Those are a single unit in width. So that's your living room and your bedroom and your deck are all composed in one of those pieces of the building. And that repeats in 5 different pieces. And that's meant to feel very residential in scale. And we're contrasting that texture of that portion of the building with Jackson Street, which is meant to be a much simpler, much cleaner. We don't have as many decks on that portion. We're using sunshades for a lot of the sun and shadowing devices, but it's using a smoother stucco versus the texture of the cementitious panels. And so this is just a rundown of those materials. You can see the windows are going to change. We're trying to get as much change and contrast between these two buildings. So the windows here are very light framed and high efficiency windows. The other building has darker frames. We're contrasting the color in the brick and the panel and the stucco. And that is it for walking around these two residential units. And we're going to talk about the park next. But first, I want to make sure you have a chance to ask any questions. And let me know how this is looking to you. Any feedback would be greatly appreciated.
Thanks, and I want to address, I want to add 2 more points, which I should have done up front. Question that always comes up is when, right? When's this going to happen? So while I'm running through the schedule, we're probably going to be looking at finishing design and permitting through the end of the year and starting construction in the first quarter of next year. So that just kind of gives you a sense for when this is going to happen. And the second thing I want to point out is that we've also, in terms of the number of units, the amount of parking, we've actually, I think, kind of increased the parking ratio for the building since our last time. So we're trying to, again, take in your considerations and maximize as much park as we can for the residents. So we're doing, I think, a pretty good job of continuing to press on that issue and get that taken care of. Leah, do you want to take it from here? Or? Yes, sure. I mean, might as well, we're talking about schedule, also talk about the park. We'll be heading to that next. But the park will be on a construction schedule where it will open by the time the first building opens, right? So when the first residential building is done, the park will be done, and everything will kind of open together at that point.
And the first building will be this building?
First building will be the building on the south at Jackson the 6th. That's right.
So with building,
No, the metered parking, everything on the street will remain as it is. And in fact, it might get a little better because we're taking out some of the curb cuts that are out there today, right? So it will be as interactive as it is today. Yeah.
What is that top
part?
Is that by residential?
Yep, it's residential on all the levels except for the ground floor. And then up at the top, we have a screening for a deck up there, so you actually get some pretty good views from up at that level. So we want to encourage residents and their guests to be able to have some gathering space, and we're creating that element to functionally to provide that gathering space and shade. But also, we really want to make sure that this is one of the devices to mark this corner as a very important corner and a gateway element. Yes.
What will the 7th Street side look like?
The 7th Street side is, it is not as much glazing, of course. We go back to a plan that the parking is actually visible from that point. That's how you enter the parking. You won't actually see into the parking, so it will be screened. We're going to have landscaping, and we're trying to minimize that exposure, of course. But with the parking across the street and the train tracks, that's where we want to come and go from parking. Some of this parking is for the park, and some of it's for retail, so we want to make sure that's very easy for people to see and find their way. So we're not showing you those elevations because those are still in development. These three faces that I just walked you through are really important in how we interact with the building. But they're going to be similar in look and appearance because of the way that the building was sort of, you know, displaying around. There's room, yes, there's the same amount of room for landscaping around that portion of the building and as the other levels. You can see that in this diagram. So the property line is that top line, and there's still additional private property to allow for greening up of that area. Yes? I think there's some room.
Me?
Yes.
Sorry. But you started the first quarter of next year. When will you finish?
Timing.
Yeah. So we're anticipating about a 24-month construction period. So I think Q1 of 2018, somewhere in that time frame.
Yeah, I just wanted to know that parking.
Sorry, 2019.
Where is the entrance to the underground parking? Are they all on set on the 7th?
Yeah. Yeah. The entrance to the parking for both buildings is off of 7th. So you'll drive in, you have access to all of this parking that's basically at that level, and then you go down the ramp to get to the end. So it's all contained in one curb cut and on 7th.
Gentlemen in the back.
I'll let you call.
Okay.
Is there going to be access to the park from 7th, or is that blocked off? So you have to walk all the way around to get in.
Absolutely, there's access from 7th. Okay. Ken's going to show you that at the next portion of the meeting.
I have a question, you get ignored.
Yeah, sorry.
The question is, the sign along on the fence says that this is going to be restricted, the park is going to be restricted to the residents that live there.
Oh, absolutely. No, this is a public park, public plaza. I have a marker, I have a current marker, maybe we should have changed that tonight.
I have two questions. One, is there a reason the parking spaces aren't accommodated underground? And two, is there any plan for affordable housing in these towers?
I'll let the owner talk about affordable housing. The majority of the parking is underground, and we're maximizing that underground parking by coming all the way out to the the property line and putting planters on top of that.
Dave, I think it looks like surface parking. There's no surface parking that's covered by a courtyard.
So this isn't on the ground floor?
This is on the ground floor, but then there is a courtyard on top of it and the rest of the building. So you never see parking in this project.
Awesome.
It's completely capped on the top by landscaping, and then it's surrounded on all sides by other uses, except for the little bit that you get in alongside. Affordable housing, sorry.
So on the affordable housing, there's not a requirement in this project to provide it, but if you go back to when we first proposed on this project, it also included the piece of property just across the street on 6th that was recently completed as a senior affordable housing. So we initially proposed with First Community Housing. They were able to proceed to develop that piece of property, and now the market rate housing is coming in. And so there's no requirement within the buildings that we're proposing for affordable housing, but it's been accommodated kind of across the street on that parcel.
Okay, how
does it count? Yeah, I just had a quick, I don't want to get caught up on the parking. I just wish I had a slide to the 7th Street side. So I got there's the underground and there's the ground level parking. And then, so I mean, are you going to see all the parking from 7th Street or?
No. You'll see a building wall. And then you'll see the units. It'll look just like. Thomas, can you go to?
No, so, just about the second. There's the amenity space at the corner. The retail is at the other corner.
Site plan.
Because it's in the floodplain, we can't put residences down in this building on this amenity space, which goes out to the Taylor Street side, and this retail goes down to the Taylor Street.
No, those are
the garage will always, the portion of the garage that you see at the top will all be screened by landscaping.
So these are units, and then when you go up one more level, they become units with a hallway down the center.
I'm just curious. And just since you don't have a slide of an elevation of the 7th Street side.
Yeah.
I was just trying to get an idea. So it'll be somewhat walled off or landscaped.
So the idea here is that this
open.
What we're doing with this facade with residences and materials is going to be reflected on this facade. It's not a symmetrical building, but we're trying to display that around. So we're going to use all the same elements, but it won't have quite as much depth because we don't need as much depth here, right? At the ground floor.
That's for me.
Well, I did come to these meetings for a long, long time. I would like to know, since you have a community meeting, what power, what authority does the community have if there need to be some changes made to what you've already planned to do? What authority do we have to change that as a community?
So today you're going to provide your input. The developer is presenting a certain design. If you're unhappy with the design, you'll be getting another notice for the public hearing. You'll come to the public hearing and be able to voice. If you have a different design or a different idea or something different, you can tell us tonight. We'll write it down. The team will think it's possible to change. If you still don't like what they proposed, you'll come to the public hearing, voice a concern. The decision maker is not me or Earl, it's our director of planning. So if you feel that a project doesn't adequately meet the appeal department, and then you take it to the planning commission, and then you present your concern to the planning commission. So you're free to give input at any time, and if the applicant doesn't show what you want to design and you want to express your concern at the public hearing, the director will weigh that in his decision. He may ask the developer to go back and look at a change, or he may approve it as is. And if he approves it and you're still not happy, you can appeal it to the planning commission.
My next question, if that's the case, would it be wise for the committee to have a meeting by themselves with the plans, and then look over it and see if there's anything that we need to talk to you about? To change this, change that, give the committee a chance to meet, everybody in the committee to meet, and then come back to you?
Sure, I believe there are some groups that meet. I know Victoria's met with a lot of people over protected intersections, so I feel like there's a lot of community involvement that meet on their own, separate and apart from the city. The plans are available at City Hall Monday through Friday, 8 to 5. You're free to look at them. I can PDF you a set of plans and you can print them out.
I think since you're presenting, you should have a plan for just the community. Have a meeting like we had now and go over it without you all being here.
You're free, you can have a meeting whenever you feel like it. And if you want it, I know, for example, Victoria had a meeting, she sent us her notes. You can have a post the meeting and send your notes to me. You have my email, I know you have my email.
That's where I'm used to having meetings.
Yeah, that's fine. You can, whenever you want it, before, we haven't set a scheduled date for the hearing. It'll probably be in the beginning of May-ish.
What has been happening is that you break what and present the rest what you already got, what you don't plan to do. And just like that, it's just, you know, I'm used to a lot of meetings, meet a lot of meetings, is that you already have in mind what you're going to do just to make us feel good. You go right about us, just give us a chance to have a voice of opinion. And yet our voice of opinion don't mean anything because you already got in your mind what you're going to do. So this is my, if we are going to include the community should have the plans and have a meeting with just the community without you all being in the meeting and go over something, discuss something, then come back to you and tell you, we don't like this, we don't like this, could you do this, could you do that? Ask, could you do this, not to force you, but ask you, is it possible, these kind of things, alter and change.
So we would like, so Pastor Davidson, if you want to arrange that meeting amongst the people you feel should be at that meeting, please do so and then send me the notes. You have to keep in mind this is a private piece of property now, it was sold. So we have to have a legal nexus for certain changes. So if they want to have a certain material on a building, we can make suggestions, suggest good urban design. What makes a good street? When you're walking down it, what makes you like this street? Are there a lot of trees? Is there glass? Is it open? We can make those strong suggestions, but sometimes certain aspects of the design are out of our control because ultimately it's private property now. So why don't you have a meeting, put a list together of things you want to see, send it to me, and we can give it to the developer. Also, if there are changes that the developer wishes to see, he can make approval conditions on certain things. So are we, can we move on? Because we do need to get to parts.
That's a consent from the you should be taking to vote with you. Committed that is here, whether or not they want to have a meeting with Dr. Hall, if we take the vote and majority says they would like to have a meeting with you all not being here, then we would do that.
It doesn't need to be voted on. All the neighborhood associations have been having meetings for years on this, for 2 or 3 years. And they have listened to our input.
I haven't been in a meeting where just the community have a meeting. I haven't been in one of those meetings. Mm-hmm. Only meetings I've been in that you all had a presentation. I can't understand you yet.
Senator? Okay, so I noticed everybody signed in probably, and so if Pastor Bates, if you wanted to call a meeting, can those email the chat? I think everybody that signed in agreed to sign in because
it's sure. So she's saying that all the people who signed in provided an email. I'll provide those emails to you, and if you want to organize a meeting, you're welcome to. You feel free to organize that meeting, and I'm saying make a list of requests or ideas, and then we'll entertain them. Is that okay?
Is it possible that we got to get ready to vote and see how many people you know?
No. It's a consensual meeting for information.
Let me talk, please.
You are hijacking the meeting, sir.
I got the vote, please. I didn't want to organize a meeting and no one showed up. But that should not say it's properly in order. If you're going to have this type of meeting, you're going to take a vote to the people here. and see whether or not they would like to have a private meeting. If they do not want a private meeting, why should I go to the problem? So I'm not looking for to be the leader of anything. I just want to know, is the majority of the people would like to have a private meeting? If not, move on. I'm happy.
So what I would suggest is, since there's other people that are currently having a private meetings and you don't wish to lead a meeting, why don't whoever else is having meetings, you can talk to him after the meeting. They can let you know when they're meeting.
That's
is that
not,
a good idea?
That's, let me decide what I want.
Okay.
I do recommend for the
I recommend running for quick votes. If the people want a private meeting, we have a private meeting. If not, I'll move on. All in favor of a private meeting, aye.
All right, can we move on?
Move on.
Okay. And but the email are available if anyone wishes to contact the greater group regarding any of this process. Two last quick questions, and we're going to move on to the parks.
I just have a quick question. I need to understand this. There's not going to be any affordable housing on this development.
Correct.
And the DDA included as the affordable housing component the seniors development cluster. Was that included in the DDA?
No, that wasn't. The development agreement actually included a provision, correct me if I'm wrong, that did not require, there was no requirement for affordable housing, the development agreement.
The development agreement was actually
required
to the city.
That's right.
Signed before the affordable housing ordinance was enacted by the council members here locally, and there's no public subsidy in this. So we don't have an affordable housing requirement, but we work with pardon?
Last question was in the front.
We can go
to the reason I was asking was because the gentleman mentioned that the community housing development process somehow that came up as a way to
meet that housing. Right, so we essentially won the rights to development for this property, you know, like in 2008. And at the time, it included that parcel across the street. And that, and our partner at the time was First Community Housing. The economy crashed, we kind of went our separate ways. They proceeded with their project. We came back as the economy improved and proceeded with ours. So they kind of got separated, but I think one other reason that the city was willing to say, okay, there's no affordable housing requirement on this is because there was affordable housing being delivered, you know, kind of as the original plan was, you know, if you go back in time. So, you know, they're not directly related at this point, but they were related at one point in time.
Front row,
one
last question.
Is the residents, are they condos or are they apartments?
They're apartments. So now what we're going to do, we're going to have Kathy Levette from Parks come up. She's going to explain to you the concept of the turnkey park. After she's done, KenKay, our urban designer, is going to present the park concept. And then we're going to have an activity. For those of you who are at the Protected Intersection meeting, it's the, no surprise, it's the same activity. We're going to hand you some dots. The red dots will be for ideas you're not too keen on. Green dots will be for good ideas that you like. We're also going to have two pieces of paper for you to put down items that you'd like to see that maybe weren't presented today. So I'm going to turn the mic over to Kathy, and the goal would be to get you up here shortly so you can start getting your input.
Thanks, Lena. My name is Kathy Levesque. I'm a supervising planner with our Department of Parks, Recreation, and Neighborhood Services. I'm also joined tonight by Rafael Gomez from our maintenance and operations team, and Mary Beth Harris, our interim deputy director. So the developer is proposing a turnkey public plaza in the central portion of the block. And in just a few minutes, KenKay from the landscape architecture firm will be up here to go through the plans, the conceptual plans, and explain what they're thinking. But the plans that they're about to present are conceptual, and they're based on feedback and comments that they've gotten from previous dialogue with the community. So tonight, you'll have an opportunity to provide feedback on those. As Leah mentioned, we will be doing a dot exercise. And after tonight's meeting, we'll be able to take your comments. The developer will work with them, come up with any possible changes, and then additionally you'll have an opportunity for feedback at our Parks and Recreation Commission, as well as our City Council meeting. So I'll turn it over to KenKay to go through the plans.
Thank you very much, Kathy. You showed me in this drawing a beautiful picture here. Are you interested in a job in landscape architecture?
What's a real job?
That's a good answer. Well, good evening, everybody. I'm pleased to be here. This is our second time to have the opportunity to present to everybody. And I'd just like to know how many people were at the first presentation. So, could you raise your hand? Okay, so quite a few of you. I'm going to show a few slides that you've already seen. But I also want you to know that we responded to a lot of the comments that you gave us in the first meeting. They're incorporated into a new plan. And these plans are approaches to coming to a solution. It's not a final solution. We have to go through a very vigorous process in terms of different agencies and different things we have to do. So all of your input is taken in. We're going to weigh the input and we're going to actually create the final plan. So this will be fairly close. I don't think it will be off unless there's something that somebody here thinks it really doesn't work. So anyway, I'm going to go through this as quickly as I possibly can. I've got about 10 minutes or something, and then we'll be able to do the talking. So Sal, if you could please go forward. So this was this is kind of stepping back a little bit in what David's presentation was. It shows you in the center of the block, there's two individual parcels. There's the Plaza Park parcel, which is right on 6th Street, and then there's the CCA building, Creative Center for the Arts. And Connie Martinez is here this evening. We're not going to be talking about that, but we're going to be showing you how all this stuff interacts as we go through. All of the special places in your town, a lot of them, not all of them, are reflected here. And also, there's a vocabulary on Jackson Street that we want to see carry through in our plan in terms of what we're doing. So next. These are the principles of I'm a landscape architect and an urban designer. These are the principles that we go by, which place making, place marking, and the most important one, I think, is place keeping. 125 years, Japantown has survived, existed. There's leadership here now that wants to carry for another 125 years. And we're hoping the park plaza redesign is going to really carry with the materials that we use in the design. It's going to be like a platform for art and creativity for many decades to come. So some of the things about nature in details is really a lot about the Japanese designs, which I have a lot of respect for. At the last meeting, we talked about the San Francisco Japantown and not liking the kind of the rustic stone, but going with something more contemporary. We have a farmer's market that's interested in being on the site, also the Tycho Drums company on the site. Then there's a notion about some public sculpture, which hasn't been decided, but we're showing an example in our plan. And then also, again, we're reflecting kind of Jackson Street, trying to extend that character through. So next. So this is not your normal park. This isn't your average door. This is a park that's going to have more hardscape than it's going to have softscape. It's not going to be active. It's really three quarters of an acre. It's 240 feet by 140. So it's relatively compact. It's not necessarily small, but it's not going to have basketball courts. It's not going to have any of the real active kind of parts of the park. This is going to be passive. This is for people to use this as an oasis to get away from basically the urban context of what they're doing. And also, it's going to be a visual park. You'll be able to look down on it from the residential. And also, it'll be for people in the community, like a town square. That's what this will be. So next. These are how big this space would be, using some examples in downtown. So the circle of columns, you can see, that's how big our design problem is. In the town, in the city, city center, you can see how big it is. Now, we guarantee you have more trees in our site than they have. So the other part is Cesar Chavez. So Cesar Chavez is the center of that, where the fountain is and all the activities. So you can see how that sort of plays out. Next. So last time we met, we showed a diagram of the CCA building because it was not designed. there was an intent to have a center to connect to the main plaza. There was a series of creative TV, there was taiko drums and different things that were part of that. But it related to this main plaza, which was the heart or the center of it. And then there's a series of outdoor rooms that we tried to design individually and integrate into the design plan. And some of those we'll be putting dots on after we have a discussion about this. These are the different elements that we have. Shade is a big thing, passive recreation, outdoor eating, and farmers market and other events. So let's go to the next one. So this is the change that we had from the last one. We have the biggest move was really to create this memory trail that goes right through the CCA building. And that memory trail is going to be made with the Heinlenville brick, the same brick that was used. And within the memory trail, there are going to be areas where you can look down and see the history, artifacts, also art from local people. And it probably will be an iPhone app for it, so you'll be able to go down and actually tell you what's on each one of these things. Sculpture will be placed at this corner. You'll be able to see it from Jackson. It will draw you down. It needs to be like a fishing lure. This passive room has a children's area, has a tai chi yoga area, and also has an arbor with benches. This side is a passive garden, very much, I'd like to say like Noguchi, I wish, but it has the same kind of quality to it. And there are entrances. There's an entrance here, an entrance on that side, and on this side. There's a sort of a river, a dry river of black stone. And then there are islands that are going to have trees that will be in those islands, and they'll be raised up high. So the trees, when they first go in, they'll be very big, and they'll give you shade immediately, even in the south, when you can sit around. And all of that is sitting areas. Everything's very low, very transparent, and so people are not going to hide. It's going to be visible, it's going to be open, but it's going to be quiet. So next. This is a rendering that we've done. So it shows 6th Street here. It shows the entry here. It shows the potential sculpture. And it shows the trail memory trail. And then it shows some of the areas and then the island goes through. So I'm going to skip through this. I don't know how much time I have. I think it's quick. Okay. So these are all labeled. It's pretty much what I just described. Last time, people have asked for an orchard style planting, which means it doesn't have fruit, but it looks like an orchard. So we'll have that in the plan. We also have a children's maze, so we'll have that in the plan that was asked for last time. And I think basically we've accomplished trying to get as much open space up against the CCA building as possible, where there will be events. We don't think there's going to be large events, but we think there will be events that will happen up in that area. And then, but this will be very quiet and interactive, so people can sit and look into each other or be in the garden or walk through it. Next. These are a vocabulary of details that we always start out with when it was very similar to what the architect showed you. There's a whole range of concepts related to furniture and character. There are activities that are part of this. Most of it is juggling, ping pong, you know, things of that scale, you know, so they're very small, intimate things versus big activities. The farmer's market also being considered in this as well. Biking, universal access. Shade is a big thing. We're going to try to do most of the shade with planting. If we really want to get the planting up high, get a big one, we get it in, so it looks full. So you don't have to wait 7 years before you go, oh, it's park. We want to make sure it really looks good. You think, Jerry? Getting it? Okay, next. So these are some sculpture things, potential seating. We'd like not to use off the bench things. And what I mean is, if you go to any park, not only here, but around the world, a lot of people get manufactured benches from a catalog that put them in the park. And they're good. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. We're going to try to use the benches that you have on Jackson Street, take the ones, put them in the park. We're going to try to use rocks and stones for benches. Things that will be unusual, will be interesting that you can sit, you can eat lunch, you can put this thing with. We're going to cite elements, and we're also going to have paving systems, so the paving doesn't look monolithic. Like, even if we use the same material, we can break it up with color.
So we're trying everything we can to make this attractive and also make it support the flexibility of what we're trying to create. Next. This is our ground level. You're in the park right now. You're looking at, we have a history wall that's here. The memory trail goes up through here. That's a potential sculpture that's there, and then the tree nest. So it, as a landscape architect also, I'm looking for trees that will live and last for a long time. So we're not trying to instantaneously, we'll be putting in old trees and Japanese maples and Chinese emeralds, things that really have a longevity. Like, this is a view. Now the building's not designed. This is an illustration of what we're trying to do with the building. So we're looking at the CCA building, and then there's an entry that we'd be going through. So this is like a portal in the park. We can walk into it. There's some potential of doing roof decks. Right? I think I made up my time. So what now? Questions? Okay.
Where is the farmer's market going?
We think farmer's market, so you go to the next one. Okay, what we think, now this is a, there's a couple alternatives. Kathy, you're going to hear with me on this. So we're either going to consider 7th Street, or we're going to have all the tents in here, tucked in like they are, and the access would be come from 7th Street. This is a 15-foot right-of-way. The truck would drive in and do their delivery stuff, but they would not go out on 6th Street. There's no vehicular access on 6th Street. So we're weighing that right now between, I'll be right. But we're just weighing that between alternative things we're doing. But this plan is the flexibility that we want to hear from everybody. There's a lot of requirements, just a certified market. So there's a whole bunch of things about not putting vegetables on the ground, you know, put them on a table. So we want to respect a lot. And there's a maker's market that's part of it. There's like small, there's a bunch of things, and I've been talking to Kathy about it, that really kind of are activators and work with the space. We just want to make sure that this space lives over time moves the way the community moves, what they need to do.
So you're going to maintenance it?
Maintain the city. Okay. Is this going to make a difference?
I don't know if anybody here is communicating with you, but the Downtown Community Congress, I'm looking around the room and I see a few of the individuals who are responsible for putting those historic benches throughout the Downtown. Have you contacted anyone about the placement of our remaining equinovans, our benches that
we have a place for them. In fact, I don't know how many do you have since we have here.
Well,
the benches are supposed to go on the sidewalk as they are currently around the whole development.
How many do we have available?
About 20, is that right?
20.
14.
So we have three immediate places, which would be great. So on the memory trail, there would be two here. There'd be one on the other side. There'd be two in here. There's a couple back here. So we can take a few of those and put them in the park. It's just how many more you want to have.
Well, we can put them on Jackson.
No, we got to put them on Jackson as well. That's right, Susie. That's right.
They are to honor certain sites like Heinlenville.
Right.
And so they need to be in front of
this. Yes, I think we bring one. And I think because this will be dedicated really to Heinlenville, that this linear spine, which has an opportunity to be, you know, people could sit and walk next to it. So anyway, now there's a gentleman here. Thank you.
Yeah, you said the city would be maintaining the park. So is the city retaining title to the property, or is the park and the performing center being guaranteed by a public easement, or is there something in the CCRs that was included in the purchase agreements? How is the community being assured, as you said, that this public space is going to be guaranteed over the decades?
The 0.75 acre plaza will become a public park. So it will be owned by the city and maintained by our parks maintenance and operations team, and it will be publicly accessible to the entire community.
And just briefly to you, and Connie and Roy could answer this question for you as well, but in terms of the CCA, that's another 0.75 acre parcel that the city will retain ownership of until the CCA is ready to begin construction, and then it will be turned over to them to own and maintain.
That's a long-term lease.
Sorry, long-term lease.
The only building, but not the land.
It's a ground lease.
It's a ground lease.
Thank you.
Okay.
The gentleman in front of the wife, and then I'll get you.
I actually foresee the public park being used by San Jose Taiko and a lot of other venues of our activities that's going to generate lots and lots of noise. Has the surfaces of the surrounding buildings with the folding paper and all this, has there been consideration to acoustical engineering to make sure that the space itself can provide a good experience for acoustically speaking?
Well, first of all, I'm probably going to ask David really about the status.
I want to
make sure
I understand the question. Is your question, sir, acoustic on behalf of the park or acoustic on behalf of the residents?
The space itself. And making sure you don't have a lot of echoing. You know, like when we designed the rotunda at City Hall, we had to put in those draped canopies as an afterthought because there wasn't enough acoustical design built into the space to prevent the echoing and everything from happening in the rotunda. Is the same type of thing consideration being made within this
space? So we have an acoustic analysis for the residential. We have not looked at what I think you're saying is acoustic that comes from the residential buildings that reflects into the park?
No.
Oh, well, we've looked at that. We have acoustic window treatments along the edges of the park. We have acoustic window treatments over by the railroad.
What are you saying for the artists?
To make the public space a really nice space as far as acoustically, have there been any considerations being made to make that space a good acoustic space?
I think the main thing is there's got to be a coordinated schedule because there's adjacencies, there's churches, there's different things. I think what would be, and there's going to be farmers market, there's going to be a lot of activities. I think it's going to have to be orchestrated in some way. We don't see this as like a big event space. So, I mean, at Tycho Drums as a building, I'm sure that they're going to do something outside sometime. But that all has to be coordinated. There has to be a site permit. There has to be different things that are done that keep it down, but keep it interesting. And then also bring not interfere with other people who already have schedules. Noise is a very difficult thing. It's like wind. It's hard to predict like where that wind shadow is. So the noise thing is going to have to be tempered. I think trees will help a bit, you know, because they're going to be part of this. But it is going to be an urban space, and it is going to have noise, and it's going to have a lot of people in it. It's going to be active. I just don't know how it's going to be tempered. So I think a lot of it's going to be scheduled and what you do and how you do it. And I don't think I could answer that right now. The gentleman in the corner.
It seems to me that the type of plantings and the context there will really reinforce the cultural context that we're trying to preserve. So by that I mean, you know, you had mentioned Japanese maples, Chinese elms, something like bonsai would be very cool here. That could last generationally. If it's maintained by the city, I don't know how long that will last. can you talk more about the types of trees and plantings here that will reinforce that? Not to be cliche, but
I think having that center there is totally crucial to the site because it's gonna keep eyes in the park. It's gonna be a place for people to go. We have to provide the shade though. We can't have it so it's where.
You mentioned the sculpture, and I mean, I don't want to offend any
anybody, but I'm just, I don't understand that sculpture potentially. That's, and then second, if you can put something really cool, like, I don't know, a huge samurai, I don't know, something.
Sure.
Well, you know, something that will actually make people drive.
Are you, come see, are you an artist? Are you an artist?
Yeah, I'm an artist too.
You've got a chance. You've got a chance. You've got to go through a public process.
Okay.
Put your name in that.
It's not
going to be that. It's a placeholder. Okay, I think I've only got a little bit of time. The gentleman in the back.
One more question. Just architecturally, these are, they're big boxes, and there's some elegance in how they deal with parking and that. But the one place, it seems to me, where the architecture can really interact with this park is the jewel boxes. And the rendering that I saw was just kind of a plain jewel box, right? Just a glass box. What if that was more organic? You had mentioned that origami theme, something like, you know, think of the bird's nest in Beijing or wherever. Just some organic form that connects the entire block to the park, in kind of an organic node architecturally.
You know, just I think that's a good suggestion, but I think that it's kind of nice that the buildings are rectilinear because the park is organic.
Yeah.
So what we're doing is we're contrasting that and we're also connecting it. Because there are places where it goes up to a podium level that has a courtyard, and there's going to be a big green space below here and then another connection on this side. So I think that, honestly, I think that's a good question, but I think Dave, we can say the same thing. And what that jewel box does, it becomes really like a mint, or it becomes kind of a community space in itself. It feeds off the parking with the park. I think it's a good suggestion. I'm going to have to close it, I think. Oh, you have a question?
When the memory lane goes through the CCA building, do you have to open a door?
Very good question. I'm hiring you for a couple of reasons. Just for your mind. But,
it's got a high operating.
Yeah, I know. It's a high operating. But the CCA building will not be open all the time. So during the day, I think you'll be able to go in, right, Connie? You'll be able to go in the building and follow that. But at night, you're going to close the door, and then you won't be able to go in. And actually, in the park, you won't be able to go in after sunset. So they're going to, you can only go in during the hours that the park is open. So that was a good question. Thank you. Okay. Well, thank you, everybody, very, very much. And we will do our best I'll say this in closing. As designers, we have to take all the input, but we don't want a community, product out of this. We want a design. So we want to get all the input and then convert it into a plan that you all will say, this is special, or I like this, I like that. But we can't fit everything into the plan. So we're going to do our best to work with everybody to make it happen. Here you go. Thank you very much.
So we'll go into our dive exercise in just a moment, but I just wanted to let you know, so we'll take the comments that we get from you tonight. The developer and the landscape architect will work on making any changes to the plans that might come out of the comments tonight. The developer is intending to go to our Parks and Recreation Commission on May 4th, which you can attend and speak and provide more feedback at that meeting. And then they intend to go to City Council on June 7th, which will be another opportunity to provide more comments. And the last step for the buildings will be the approval or denial, which we're hoping for approval of the PD permit. That will be publicly noticed. It'll be a director's hearing, so it's 9 a.m. on Wednesday. We're hoping for the beginning to middle of May, so be on the lookout for that in your mail. So Kathy wants to know things you don't want with the red, things you do want with the green, things that you don't see on the boards, you can write, we have pens over there. And then we'll release the group, and then if you have individual questions, we're going to be here while you do it. Okay? Thank you for coming.
Leon Jackson, across 4th Street. There's a service station right on the corner. The Auto Works. Our store is right next to it. Our parking lot.
What is your store?
It's your business store.
So, if you're
that is that service?
Open space.
But that's up there.